This week on Maker Update, an upside-down 3D printer, a step-and-snack fanny pack, telling time with bubbles, paper cutters, Loki crowns, and making sacrifices to Leatherface. Hello and welcome back to another Maker Update. I'm Tyler Weingartner and I hope you're doing great. I recently got to visit with a whole gang of makers here in upstate New York. It was a great opportunity to recharge the creative batteries. I've got an awesome show for you, so let's check out the project of the week. There's a lot of different designs for FDM 3D printers, but pretty much every single one has the printhead in the same orientation, with the nozzle pointing downwards and extruding the plastic in vertical layers. But Krayln 3D has a radical new design for a 3D printer that's not only portable and compact, but it turns the entire design for FDM printers on its head, and it's called the Positron. It might not be obvious, but gravity has very little effect on FDM 3D printing. We know this because there's a 3D printer on the ISS that can print in microgravity. But that doesn't mean that designing a printer in this way is as easy as just flipping the Z-axis. To make it easy to inspect the first layer for print problems, the heated build plate is a clear piece of borosilicate glass. To keep the gantry as compact as possible, it's driven by an inverted H-bot drive. And to keep the extruder as short as possible, the hot end makes a right angle bend so it doesn't need to be as tall as a conventional printhead. And it's not all clever design for clever design's sake. Because of that right angle in the hot end, the heated part of the nozzle is larger and can push more plastic without under extrusion. And because the printhead is lighter and the gantry is more rigid, it can print faster and more accurately while maintaining a low center of gravity. And because the gantry is rotated 45 degrees, it increases the build volume without increasing the footprint of the machine. Over the past few years, we've seen good FDM 3D printers get cheaper and 3D printers get better overall, largely due to advancements in software and firmware. But this is the most radically different printer design I've seen in a good long while. It may not turn into the next craze in printer design, but it's exciting all the same. At the time of this video, Krayln 3D has released a bill of materials, design files, PCB files, and configuration settings for the Positron, and plans to do a full video build series so you can build your own and put it through the paces. Check it out down in the description. More projects. We've seen ultrasonic levitators before, but not quite like this one. From UpnaLab comes the SonicSurface. It's a pair of jumbo-sized PCBs, each one carrying 256 ultrasonic emitters in a 16 by 16 grid. And what can you do with such an outlandish number of emitters? Well, this. The whole thing is managed by a pair of FPGA processors and a single Arduino Nano. One of my favorite parts of this project is the custom software for positioning and animating the foam pellets. This is a complex and expensive project to build, but I don't think I've ever seen anything quite like this. On Instructables, I found this project by Shinoda Y, where they've built a numerical display made entirely out of illuminated air bubbles. Currently functioning as a clock, when it's time to display a new number, a roll of solenoid valves introduces bubbles into these vertical tubes, which are flooded with glycerin. Similar to an old dot matrix printer, the number is made out of several rows and columns of bubbles that then slowly drift up and out of sight. It takes a while for each number to form, and the numbers deform pretty quickly as they float up out of the display. But it makes a cool, soothing sound as each digit is formed, and it's incredibly cool to watch. Over on YouTube, after a long hiatus, Lynn from Darbin, Orvar is finally back to making videos. She's already released two, and both of them are related to bookbinding. In this one, she creates a type of paper cutter called a book plow. Instead of a traditional guillotine-style paper cutter, the pages of the book are held in a bookbinding vise, while a blade is attached to the sliding carriage to cut the pages. The result is a clean and effortless method of cutting all the pages to size. Also check out the build video for the bookbinding vise, just to see how she built these wooden lead screws. If you've been watching the Loki series on Disney Plus, you've probably fallen in love with a certain character who appears towards the end of the series, and maybe thought, could my pet be a Loki variant? TechnoChic has an instructable to show you how to make a Loki crown for your pet. If you've never worked with craft EVA foam, this is a super accessible tutorial with a ton of great tips, like how to use your scissors to get a clean line, where to add sculpture wire. It's good stuff. And finally, on the Hackaday blog, I found this ridiculous project from Sam March, who has built a fanny pack that dispenses a single M&M every time he walks 100 steps. The device is simple enough. Data from the accelerometer is used to determine when a step is taken, and once 100 steps get counted, an auger ejects a single M&M from the hopper. The decision to serve a single piece of candy every 100 steps is purposeful. Since the average person burns a single calorie every 25 steps, and a single M&M contains 4 calories, he's achieved caloric equilibrium. It's silly and kind of pointless, but it works. I also love how he came up with this idea. He's been collaborating with fans on his channel to give him ideas for his projects. Once he completes the project, it gets gifted to the person who he collaborated with. It's a great way to get out of a creative rut and also sends the project off to a happy home so you don't get stuck with it. We're kicking off this week's tips and tools section with 10 bullets, the original heavyweight video from the Tom Sachs studio. And this one is full of incredible tips. This video was originally released as the 10 essential rules of working at the Tom Sachs studio. It covers topics like thought process, organization, workflow, and communication. They're very particular about how this studio works, so carbon copying these to your own workspace might not work for you. But it's an essential thought exercise in determining how you work best, whether you're alone in your own shop, working with a small team on a large project, or establishing the rules of conduct in a makerspace. Although one rule every workspace should adopt, always be Nolan. From Create Inc., I found this video about how to make 3D prints with seemingly impossible features, like printing in midair with no support. The heart of this process is a website that allows you to write formulas to generate G-code parametrically, and he spends a good bit of time explaining how to use it to get simple and increasingly more complex results. Because he's generating the G-code directly and without a slicer, he's able to inject custom code, like shifting the print speed way down to achieve these seemingly impossible overhangs. This is a completely different approach to 3D printing, but you should be able to use it to get some really unique results. Over on her channel, Liz Clark from Blitz City DIY takes a quick look at the ASUS Tinkerboard 2. The Tinkerboard 2 is a single board computer with a similar form factor to the Raspberry Pi, but with a total of 6 cores of processing power and a comically large heatsink. The bulk of the test consisted of running a series of benchmarks on the Tinkerboard 2 and comparing the scores against the original Tinkerboard and the Raspberry Pi 4. There's a few surprises in the data, but overall, if you need a single board computer with a little more grunt than a Raspberry Pi, this could be the answer, though you might find yourself very much on your own. There's a much smaller user base for the Tinkerboard and not as much software available. But really, why can't every single board computer have color-coded GPIO? Please? Lastly, I thought there was a great tip on bending aluminum in this project video from Narwhal Labs. In the video, they're building touchscreen, kiosk-style computers to use in the shipping department of Total Boat and Jamestown Distributors. To build the sturdy enclosure, they're milling out flat pieces of aluminum with this slotted pattern at the places where the shapes need to be bent. That's a great tip on its own, but the other piece of the puzzle is using the right type of aluminum. 6061 is easy to mill, but tended to break instead of bending. 3000 series alloys bent beautifully, but tended to gum up the milling bits. But 5000 series alloys was the sweet spot. Easy to mill, but remain flexible enough to be bent. For this week's Digi-Key Spotlight, I found this slightly older video in their Another Teaching Moment series, and it's all about fans. Axial fans, centrifugal fans, tangential fans, blower fans, there's a lot of different ways to move some air around. This video covers the considerations of fan shape, the amount of air it can move, and also touches on a few other considerations like ducting. If you want to keep your projects cool in the summer months, give this one a look. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. I feel like this is a really strong week for creative, outside-of-the-box types of projects. I really enjoyed putting it together, and I hope you enjoyed watching it. If you did, leave us a comment, hit subscribe, and give us a thumbs up. It'd be super cool to see more people doing that thing from Sam March's video, where folks dare one another to make different kinds of projects. Maybe leave a dare for someone down in the comments. Just maybe not rocket-powered skates. It's been done. As always, huge thanks to the folks at Digi-Key for making this show possible. Take care out there, and I'll see you soon.